Let's look at reactions of epoxides in a few different conditions. So for reactions in acid, we're typically going to see addition at the more substituted carbon be preferred. So here we've got a tertiary carbon versus a primary. So we end up seeing that tertiary carbon get our nucleophile methanol here. And I say unhindered nucleophile, so something up to about the bulkiness of an ethanol or isopropanol, we're going to see again this trend hold. But if we got something up to a nucleophile bonded to say a T-butyl group, that's getting to be a point where we wouldn't see as strong of a trend. Okay, but in general we're going to see this hold. Substitution at the more substituted carbon is going to be preferred. And why that is we see a protonation of our epoxide from our acidic conditions, and so we've protonated our solvent and methanol here in our reaction, and so we'll see that lone pair grab an extra proton. We are protonated, and now all of a sudden this is a very strained ring system, and it tries to almost open up. So it gets to the point where it stretches this bond going towards the tertiary position, lengthens it out, and puts a pretty significant delta plus on the more stable substituted carbon, not quite a full carbocation. And this has to do with the way really strained rings bond and their hybridization being a little bit different than a normal sp3 center. But we create just enough room in this situation for our nucleophile to come in the form of our solvent, attack this position, open up the rest of the epoxide, and now we've got a protonated ether and we've got an alcohol on the other side that opens up to the less substituted side. So then we just take our solvent molecule to finish out our bookkeeping with our arrows here, deprotonate, and we've got our product. So to take this second step, this is a workup step that would be performed in lab to quench the excess acid once the reaction is over. So we do our epoxide opening, we'd get to an equilibrium of our product and our protonated ethanol, and then we would get rid of that protonated ethanol by our weak base. The weak base prevents any side reactions from occurring with other functional groups that may be present. And sodium bicarbonate would return our methanol and then break up into CO2 and water. So that's what that second step is about, is isolation of the neutral at the end, okay? All right, so anyway, let's look at arene oxides and the dreaded NiH shift. And it's not dreaded, it's just, it's a mechanistic curiosity that we need to look at here. And so let's remember that a functional group, an arene oxide, has two double bonds and it's almost a benzene ring. In fact, this NiH shift in a protic solvent or acidic conditions will occur by protonation of our epoxide. And so we're going to form, let's remember, we've got a meso compound here, that epoxides are on the same side of a ring surface there. So they are formed by syn additions, and so we need to remember that. Now we've got a protonation there, and at this point we have a stable cation that we can form. And so we go ahead and open this up. Let's show it occurring to this way, since we did show our final product carbon having that oxygen. So it opens up and we see a stable allylic cation form. And so we've got resonance that's occurring throughout this system. We can resonate that positive charge and stabilize it. And so then what occurs if we draw in our hydrogens that we have, okay, now we started with them being back away from us, and now one's still back away from us, the other's planar because we have an sp2 cation. We can close this to a double bond and push with neighboring group assistance and chimeric assistance to push that hydride over and accomplish the shift. And so what we end up with in the end is a protonated ketone and our two hydrogens now. The stereochemistry no longer matters because we've got two hydrogens on the same carbon. And what we've got is an enone, but normally a ketone's more stable, but here we get tautomerization. We can take our solvent molecule and deprotonate, kick back up to an alcohol, and we form an aromatic phenol, which is the most stable of all, and this is practically irreversible at this point because of the aromatic stability that we have in the ring. So we'll see a significant portion of phenol conversion in these acidic conditions. So what if we have basic conditions, not for arene oxides, but for just epoxides in general, like we saw in the first couple of examples there. We've got reactions going to be preferred at the less substituted position, the most easily accessible, the lowest transition state energy for that attack. And so if we take a nucleophile such as the cyanide ion, we can attack the less substituted position, kick up our alcohol, and form directly here an alkoxide with our nucleophile on the other side. On the less substituted side, the alcohol ends up on the more substituted side. And then we add a little bit of weak acid at the end so it doesn't interfere with other functional groups. A little ammonium chloride, acetic acid is just fine here as well. And what we'll get is a protonation of our alcohol or alkoxide, and we get our final product. And so that workup step, again, helps us to isolate the final product and takes care of that O- exchange, brings the pH of our system up so we don't have any loss to the aqueous layer as we're extracting away our byproducts of the reaction. Okay, so attack at the less substituted positions, always preferred. In these conditions, we can make a trans diol. And so we'll see hydroxide is able to attack the backside of the epoxide, kicking up in an SN2 reaction. We end up with, in one case where we attack the left-hand side, we end up with this intermediate that's then protonated by our workup step, again, with our acetic acid. This time, we're just showing a couple of ways to do this. With the workup step, a nice weak acid, and we get our trans diol. The other enantiomer is from attack at this carbon. Now, we can also attack with organocuprates, and in a similar way to basic conditions, attack the less substituted side. The cuprate mechanism is coupling. We won't show that. We can consider it as, if we're conceptually, as we're attacking this position and kicking up to that alkoxide. And so if we do that, we get our carbon backbone, but now we have to think about protonating that. There's no other functional group present. Let's use a strong acid this time, like HCl. It's going to proton transfer to hydronium, to a hydronium ion in a water solvent. And so we'll show it as coming off of water here. And so we get that protonation. No other functional group present. Why not use a strong acid in the workup step here? But we can attack with an organocuprate to couple carbons onto an epoxide, forming an alcohol at the more substituted position.